today.
Yeah. That's always exciting. Another one. Another one in the books, eh?
Another one.
Another one bites the dust.
Okay.
All right.
It's not working.
Another one bites the dust.
This working.
Yo, get it.
Is Chris's mic on?
Hello.
No. Again?
Hello. Yes, it's on now.
Yeah, it's good.
Testing 1, 2.
Joe.
Welcome back,
Uncle Jack.
Welcome back, Uncle Jack.
Well, Flapjack, Paddywhack.
Flapjack, Paddywhack.
So good.
So have you guys given thought to the next book?
EQ, I haven't even looked at it yet. I have no idea what it's about.
Okay.
I bought two books recently that I need to listen to. One I'm waiting for in November, and one that I bought yesterday. The Beastie Boys, the book.
Ah. Beastie Boys.
It's highly rated. Like it's.
It's like popular. Is it like an autobiography?
Yeah.
Those are nice.
I like that stuff.
Yeah, me too. I like that stuff too.
To be honest.
It beats fiction.
Yeah, but yeah, for sure. But the reason why I'm doing this book club with you guys is because I would never read these books if it wasn't for this.
Okay.
But
so that's the only reason?
Well, I enjoyed doing this, but like I wouldn't be reading these books if it wasn't for you guys. Because I prefer reading, like Shoe Dog for me was the best.
Yep.
Gotcha.
Mind you, digital minimalism was really good.
Yeah.
Do you remember when I brought up last week the what you would do if you saw your son being bullied?
Yeah.
In the park? It's in chapter 11.
Yeah, he does talk about that.
Mm-hmm.
It's in chapter 11. I skipped there. My chapters are all messed up because I've read this before.
People are starting to roll in. We got 4 people tuned in right now.
Welcome, peeps.
Welcome, everybody. We usually just shoot the shit for a few minutes, and then we get into the book club, letting people get here.
Are you still doing .fr?
What is .fr?
Français.
No. Okay. No, we do that for la visite.
Are we doing this in French, too?
We should.
I don't know about that, man.
No. Bilingual channels usually don't do so well.
Yeah.
Yeah, just because you're splitting your audience in two.
Yeah.
And
you'd have to make 2 podcasts.
Yeah.
Unless you have subtitles that will automatically. That would be a nice app. I'm sure there's something like that.
Did I ever tell you about the translation error for one of my guests on the podcast?
No.
So I was going to host this guy, Mathieu Beausoleil. He's got a YouTube channel.
This is for your La Visite podcast, right?
Yeah, okay. French.
Yeah.
Ça m'excitait de recevoir Mathieu Beausoleil.
Yeah, it's French, but it's like franco-anglais.
De la chaîne YouTube.
Franco-ontarien, yeah.
Taking a bite.
Yeah.
Il va être sur l'épisode plus tard cette semaine, blah, blah, blah. So I post that in French on Facebook.
Mm.
Facebook recognizes that it's in French. So it translates everything into English from my post.
Yeah.
This week we are happy to receive Mathieu Beausoleil from the popular YouTube series Taking a Dick.
No.
Fuck.
No way, man.
Yeah, man.
Oh my god.
Yeah, translations can get you into trouble.
Can you change the translation? Like, can you translate it yourself?
You can turn off translations.
Okay.
So if you post something in
Because French, a lot of things that you post online in French, when I read it in English, it makes no sense.
On Facebook?
Yeah. It makes, like, especially you and Marie-Pierre. I get that a lot.
Yeah.
It's like I'd read it in English and this does not make any sense.
I think if you press translate once, it's always going to translate until you deactivate it.
Okay.
Am I correct on that? Or?
Well,
so you can deactivate the translation. And
because I pressed translate once for someone and it's been translating ever since.
Okay.
Ah. Yeah.
Like when my father-in-law passed away, I said, "Salut mon chum," and it said, I'll see you later, my boyfriend.
Yes. Yes. Like, I saw that. Yeah.
So
that was one of them.
That's cute,
I think,
man.
Yeah.
That's cute.
Yeah. It is cute.
It is cute. Special guy.
Yeah, for sure.
I think it's funny how we keep talking about AI and pushing AI. You know, we're there. But we can't even fucking translate taking a bite, you know?
Yeah.
Like,
yeah,
well, that's the thing.
Slow your roll and work on the stuff that's broken.
It's all computerized, man. Like, you need that human touch. You need the human touch for sure.
Yeah.
People that are watching right now, can you let me know if the sound's okay, if the mic is not working well, or just let me know if something's wrong with the sound.
Do not bother children when they are skateboarding, and pet a cat when you encounter one in the street.
So rule number 11 and rule number 12. From Jordan Peterson's 12 Rules for Life.
That concludes the book.
It is our sixth and final week for this book.
Mm-hmm.
Great book so far.
Yep.
Right?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
But the way we break this down is we usually read a few chapters per week, and then we get together on Thursday mornings at 9:30 a.m. thereabouts, and we discuss what we've read for the week.
Yeah.
So, I guess we'll jump right into chapter 11. Mm-hmm. Do not bother children when they are skateboarding. Yep. A very important rule, in my opinion, in this world that we are constantly trying to make safer and safer and safer for everybody.
Yep.
I think we're succeeding in making things safer, but we're also robbing people from the gift of learning from danger.
The gift of mistakes.
Yes.
Yeah.
When he talks about skateboarding, he also mentions like snowboarders or skiers or surfers, anything dangerous, really.
Yeah.
So he talks about his friend Chris, that basically is going on a downward spiral. He almost burns down the kitchen, and he tried to use that as an excuse that he was fixing the stove because he couldn't accept himself cooking food because that's apparently, quote unquote, a woman's job.
Yes.
Right? And then one quote that really got to me is when he said that Chris, the person he was talking about, needed to develop some humility. He needed to get a life. So he is connecting humility with getting a life. As if to get a life, you need to experience a lot of humility. You need to do mistakes. Yeah. You need to be embarrassed. And that's really cool because if you don't take these risks, if you don't try to advance, you're never going to, if you're not going to get embarrassed, rejected, you're never going to get over that hump.
Yeah.
Right? Mm-hmm. And you'll end up smoking 50 packs of cigarettes a day, drinking all day, no job, living at your friend's couch. Living off of your friend's couch.
Like sheltered.
Chris? Sheltered.
Yeah.
Like Chris? Is that what you're saying?
Like Chris. Yeah.
Well, I cooked yesterday.
No
shame there. I made myself a nice filet mignon. On an electric barbecue, it's not as good.
Like a George Foreman type thing?
No, just like...
those things are absolutely nasty, eh? The George Foremans?
I've never used one.
It takes away all the fat. It's not good.
Got me through college.
Oh, yeah?
George Foreman?
Oh, fucking right.
Did you do like Michael Scott and cook your foot? You remember that episode? But anyways,
so how did it turn out?
Fantastic. Nice. Just it's not a real barbecue, but other than that...
You cook that in the house?
No, on the...
Outside?
Yeah.
Okay. On the balcony?
It's kind of like a camping barbecue, almost.
Yeah.
It's the next best thing, I guess.
Yeah.
I'd love to have a barbecue.
They're probably just as good. It's just it's more fun to cook over a flame or charcoal.
Yeah, for sure.
You know, it's fun in it.
But if you do have a friend like Chris...
Yes.
He's going through a downward spiral.
Yeah.
he is giving up on life. He has a weird, and I think this whole thing with Chris started when he was getting bullied earlier in his life at school. And Jordan talks about how he was getting bullied by the natives.
Yes.
Natives were a lot more aggressive. And he told a story where, you know, one native was going out, he was chasing after him, and then Jordan admitted that he still wants to go to the movies with him. Then the guy cried off. Remember that? Okay, so in that, and then after that, he mentioned how Chris was handling the bullying. He wasn't fighting for himself. He basically gave up on life. Eventually gave up on men, on being a man. Then eventually turned
women.
On women and started hating women.
Yeah. Yeah.
So he basically hated both genders.
Yeah, he was an involuntary celibate.
Right.
Right? So he wasn't attractive to anybody. And he refused to compete against other men.
No.
Because if he didn't compete, he didn't have to lose.
Exactly.
You shouldn't revert to rule number one.
To stand straight with your shoulders back.
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
my favorite rule, by the way.
Yeah,
for sure. I live by that every day. So, but somebody like Chris, like, you feel bad for him. But at the end of the day, man, like, get a life.
Yes.
Help yourself.
Do something. Yeah, but it's so much easier said than done.
Uh-huh. There's a really strange relationship between danger and mastery of anything, right? And I started reading this chapter and I thought to myself, how does this apply to my life? And it applies to anything that you're trying to do. I was, you know, looking at my guitar and my house, and I'm not really getting better at the guitar because I'm playing alone in my condo. Nobody's listening to me. But I thought...
Even your girlfriend walked out, eh?
Please don't tell me you're going to start a YouTube channel with you.
No, but what it's easy enough to sit on your couch, practice playing the guitar, and you might get slightly better. And and over time, you learn to play. But if you had to play in a public setting and a specific date, you would definitely put more effort into your practice.
Yeah.
So right now, the only person I'm playing for is myself. And I mean, my girlfriend knows how bad I am at guitar, so it's no surprise for her, right? When I don't hit the notes. Okay. But, you know, if I knew that, you know, for Christmas, I'm going to sing a song for the family.
Oh, God.
You know,
it's like those guys
that
had
to sing or
dance for their wedding, you know what I mean?
Yeah. So if you have a date and you say, okay, well, there's a danger there. So that's the relationship between danger and mastery, right? So I know that December 24th or 25th, I'm going to be performing in front of a few people, and there's dangers of being embarrassed.
Right.
That would lead to mastery.
Humility.
Yeah, humility would help you master.
Well, at least you'd hope so. You know what I mean? You're like, I'm going to book myself a show, a gig, and I'm going to become good. And then you just crash and burn and you never play again.
Well, listen, it's better like that than to be a complete superstar. Like, I think I was watching a Mariah Carey video yesterday. A Mariah Carey video.
Okay.
And her, like her last performance for Christmas was absolutely atrocious. Like it was just horrible.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Like very bad. I'd rather be in a position where I'm learning and getting better than being on top of the world and then regressing.
Oh, yeah, of course.
You know? Like, you hear a lot of football players that are, they were on top of the world and then they get cut and now they are complete.
In her case, nobody's. Though, that was a one-off, I'm sure.
No, like, man.
Well, she has a fucking residency in Vegas right now.
Yeah, but apparently it's not that good. But Britney Spears had a residency in Vegas. Yeah. She lip-syncs the whole time, right? Like, I'm sure she's lip-syncing.
I don't know, man. I'd have to see it. I'd pay money to see Mariah Carey.
You're all about the divas, eh, this year? You just saw Celine
Dion?
Yeah.
I sent my mom and grandmother to go there yesterday, and she's leaving Rockland at 5:30. I'm like, Mom, you're going to be late. Sure enough, she calls me almost crying. Oh, we're going to be late, and I need to go to the bathroom. I'm like, I fucking told you so.
What time did the concert start at?
7:30. She called me at 7. They were like
a lot of traffic.
5 minutes away.
Yeah.
But she brought my grandmother, who can't stay put for 2 seconds because her back hurts and stuff like that.
Like, thank God for these concerts, eh? Because otherwise the Suns are not bringing anything in. Anyway.
Yeah.
Talk about humility.
Yeah.
What a joke.
You know how he talks about play structures in schoolyards At one point, they were just removing the whole structures because they were dangerous. I remember why are you laughing?
No, I remember what happened on those play structures when we were kids. And
dude, I fell off, lost conscious, woke up like at a different place on the field, and just like, what the hell just happened?
Won't
no
do
one
that
ever
again.
Came to see me if I was okay.
Yeah.
But did I jump over that slide again? Yeah, but I didn't fall that time. I
no, you learned.
Yeah.
Anyways.
Like, I mean, like, look at these skateboarders.
Oh, sorry.
Like,
I was just, the reason why I'm saying this is because they're making them safer and safer, and now kids aren't playing with them anymore. Can't even play tag anymore. You can't fucking.
That's so crazy.
I know, man.
It's sorry, didn't mean to cut you off.
No, you were making your point, and it's crazy. I don't know.
We were talking about Pogs a few episodes ago. Remember?
Yeah.
And marbles.
Yeah, and then the school system said, well, you can't play for keeps anymore. But that's the danger.
Of course.
You're losing your shit.
Yeah. It's gambling.
You're breaking your collection. Right?
Yeah.
If you're not going to play, do as I did and just fucking start stealing Pogs. You know?
Well, no, it might lead to that type of behavior, right?
Because I had this tube of Pogs, like maybe this big, filled with spawn Pogs. They were worth a lot of money.
Yeah.
So I would walk around and
But what's a better life lesson than Pogs? Think about Pogs, man. Like, you're playing, you lose your marbles, right?
Yeah.
Like, you're losing it if you lose. So you have to get better at it.
Of course.
So you work at getting better at it.
Yeah. And if you're not losing and there's no consequence, then, you know, you're just going to be...
It's a great lesson for adulthood, for sure.
It is.
I don't know why they would do that. Like, just keep them playing.
Put something on the line. Let the kids put something on the line.
Exactly.
Don't shelter them because that's not real life.
Because not everybody's a winner. Like, some people are going to be losers and they need to become winners. And to be a winner, you have to lose.
Yeah, but the losers, if they can feel the loss and learn from it, then they make their way into becoming, you know, something else.
Yeah.
We're not teachers, so we don't really know what's happening these days, I'm sure. But like, I know back in our days, we would fucking throw kids off snow mountains, play King of the Mountain. And then when I was on top, like, I was the happiest kid ever. I was thrown off.
Yeah.
Believe me, I would crawl back up and throw that off the hill, you know?
King of the Mountain.
Yeah. That was so fun.
I loved that game.
Yeah, it's fun.
Remember when we would build forts and throw snowballs at each other like we were in war?
Trying to destroy the other person.
Well, did they ban that too? You're not allowed to do that anymore?
I don't know. Sure. You can't throw snowballs. You crazy? What if you hit someone?
One with a little rock in it.
What if you hit somebody?
Well, exactly.
That's the point. Cool. Anything else on this rule number 11 to not bother children while they are skateboarding?
Yes, I think I want to talk about one more thing.
Okay.
So he talks about the Oedipal mother. What page is that?
Oh. While you're looking for that, one important point. He talks about men versus women and how it's tough for a guy to succeed. I don't know how to put this, but like he talks about how women can dominate within their industry between women, and they can also dominate within the men's side of whatever it is, whether it's sports, whether it's work or school. But for a guy, you can't cross over to the women's side because it's like considered a lower level. So you can only compete within the guy's side of things.
Right.
So he says that it's tough for a guy, basically, because you have to fight even more.
Mm.
I don't know how to put that, but you guys know what I'm talking about?
Yeah, he did talk about that. It's a very difficult subject to talk about, but it is different. And we got to stop talking about being a man and being a woman like it's the same thing, because it's not.
No.
And I'm all for, you know, equality of opportunity. So if you are the best fireman, then even if you're a woman, you should be on the squad.
Yep.
But I don't think it's right that we have to have 20% of our firefighters be women just because we want to be
diversified.
It's just
diversified.
It's the easy way out.
Well, companies right now are taking a look at their diversity ratio. And that's an actual ratio that companies look at, right? For women, for men, for different nationalities, you know? And cool, that's great, that's the way it should be. We should have diversity in the workplace, but not because it's being given to people, because, you know, we're just choosing the right candidates to do the right job.
Yeah.
For a long time, people that were trying to get into the police force were being turned down because they were from here, they were white men, you know, and the police wanted to be diversified. Mm. And I think it's great. I think it's good that there's diversity in the police force. Mm. But I don't think it should be enforced.
I think the reason why it is enforced is because of...
because it needed a boost.
Historical human behavior.
Yeah.
Right? Like, regardless what you do, where you're from, it's more natural to side with somebody that you can relate to.
Okay.
And if that somebody happens to come from the same country that you were born, oh, you come from the same village, you know his dad, he knows your dad, blah, blah, blah. You're more likely to give him the job, right?
Gotcha.
And I think they're trying to avoid that, because when you're coming in from a different country, it's very unlikely that you know anybody here, right?
Yeah.
Like, you know your family, and your family is probably not in the police force. And for the longest time, I'm sure that connections played a huge factor in getting into the police force. Until now, they just switched it up.
Well, of course. Same thing as the government.
Yeah. Like,
the
if,
same
yeah.
thing for the government, right?
And it's like that in every country. It's not any different. Here, the thing is, in the Western world, racism is just a lot less tolerable. In other countries, it's very normal. It's very normal. Discrimination is a lot less tolerable here. People don't stand discrimination at all. Like, they get offended really fast. In other countries, it's very normal.
So when was the last time you spent time in Lebanon?
In 2016.
And do you still find it's very polarized? Like, people of certain descent will hire only people of a certain descent?
100%.
Yeah.
Like, I went to a village where they can do, I told you about this. In a village, you have to be a certain religion and a certain sect from that religion to buy. And to buy real estate in that village,
or else no good,
you know.
Ouch.
Like, it's so normalized.
That's rough.
In other countries, here we're just, it doesn't, it's not tolerable at all. And I wanted just to go back with, when it comes to men and women, you were talking about, like, at the end of the day, the woman that has a family is going to probably take more time off work than the man would. Okay?
Yeah.
But if you compare a woman that does not take any time off for her children and her family to a man that doesn't take time off for his children or his family.
Yeah.
Okay, like when they're sick, or when obviously they don't go on mat leave, they go on pat leave. Now you have pat leave and mat leave. But anyway, they take more sacrifice. They have historically taken more sacrifice than the man and the woman. Woman have taken more sacrifice than men have, right?
Definitely.
And that did not help them advance their careers as much as it helped the men advance their careers.
Yeah.
So I think that's the biggest, that's the underlying issue, and why there's some sort of inequality maybe.
But we're using only money earned as the metric here.
Okay.
So if we used another metric, time spent with family, then I would guess that the men are not spending as much time with their family as they would like.
Probably not.
So, on an individual basis, everybody can make as much money as they want. But if you look at the population as a whole, then interesting numbers will start to pop up, right?
I get that. But when you make a decision to have a baby,
yes,
with your wife, this decision is an equal decision. Except, she's carrying the baby. She's going through all the hormonal changes.
Yeah.
She's getting sick. She's going to the washroom more often. It's affecting her mood. It's affecting her life completely. Okay? So it's also affecting her career. So for the 9 months that she's at work, she's not herself.
No.
Well, superstar, on the other side, you know, he's waking up in the morning, he's doing a few push-ups, stretching, taking his fish oil, going to work. He's a superstar. I mean, he has a huge advantage. While the other one, she's barely rolling out of bed because she can't, she's uncomfortable. And then on top of that, she's taking another year to stay with her kids.
But isn't it the role of the man to go to work and to...
But now we're talking about roles.
To provide for the family?
Well,
so doesn't...
But women nowadays are more educated than men.
Yes.
Right?
And
women are more educated than men.
And I've known women that have gone back to work 2 weeks after giving birth.
Yeah, well, I have no idea how they do that.
That's crazy.
That's not a good idea.
But
we're talking about Renee staying at home for 18 months, and I'm all for it, man.
Of course.
I want her to stay at home for 2 years if it's possible.
Of course.
Yeah.
And when we hear about these differences in income, right, I don't think we take that into factor, right? Of course it's going to make a difference.
But we're talking about careers here, but...
Well, no. It doesn't... We're talking about men and women and how... They are different fundamentally.
Yeah. But like he doesn't necessarily talk about careers. It's mostly everything.
Competing.
Like, let's talk about the guy who went through a sex change and wanted to fight women in the UFC. Like, why? That does not make any sense.
Well, the opposite wouldn't make any sense at all. If a woman wants to fight men.
No, but it'd be allowed.
It would be allowed, sure, but it's a huge disadvantage for her or him. And the opposite is a complete advantage.
Let's say Usain Bolt.
Let me tell you something. If they allow men to change into women and compete in the Olympics, I will no longer watch the Olympics because it's unfair.
It is. But what if...
Serena Williams is not fair. She should be allowed to compete and fucking... Yeah.
So I don't... who's the female sprinter for Canada? Felicia or
I have no idea.
Anyway, she jumps hurdles.
What about the American that's killing the game right now?
A girl just
beat Usain Bolt's.
I heard that in the relay.
Yeah.
So if she makes it to the main event at the Olympics, the men's 100 meter. Sprint.
I think that was a bit over exaggerated because it's a relay. It's not like a one on one.
So if she got there, she competed against Usain Bolt and all the other guys, and she won, it'd be celebrated.
She's the fastest person in the world.
Yeah.
But if Usain Bolt runs with the women on the 100 meter.
But that on his own, like Usain is celebrated already as the fastest human alive, right? Like, so you're including men and women in that.
But that's what he's saying here, is that the margin for us men to like be successful is much smaller than it is for women. They have more to go after.
More playing.
They can be in their women's world and
more playing field.
It's slowly changing though, I think. And I just don't feel.
Well, how though? How are you gonna go play basketball and fucking dunk on a woman and like celebrate it, like, you know,
or smash? Like
that would be so cowardly.
Like Gregory Fokker and Meet the Fockers when he plays volleyball and he smashes a volleyball. What's wrong with you, Greg?
Are you guys cool if we switched and talk about the Oedipal mother? It's Oedipal. Google it. It's a really cool term.
Edible mother.
Edible.
So the lady that shelters her son from everything?
Yeah.
In return for his unconditional love?
Unconditional love. She never wants him to leave the house, basically, right?
Yes.
That is so horrible.
It is, man.
And it comes down to, again, we talked about the, you know, what would you do if you see your kid getting bullied? You can't protect your children from everything. And it's almost detrimental to the kid's life, you know,
like it's
probably the worst thing a mother can do.
Don't worry, son, you're not wrong. Everybody else is wrong.
Yeah.
You're right.
Mm-hmm.
It's unfair that you lost the basketball game
against
a team that trains five times a week and you only train once a week.
Yeah.
The ref was on the other people's side.
I used to see that a lot while I was coaching. This is why this resonated with me. I used to see it with, you know, single mothers. It's their only child, you know. The father is completely out of the equation at this point. And sometimes he is, but it's actually worse when the father is not out of the equation.
Okay.
Because she wants this. She wants her son to love her more. So she would do absolutely anything for him, anything he wants. Okay. And even when he's wrong on the football field, like he fumbles the ball or he doesn't listen in practice. She doesn't blame the son. She blames the coaches.
When he gives up on a play.
Yeah. She doesn't blame the son. They're not giving him the ball enough. Or
it was a bad throw by the quarterback.
It was a bad throw by the quarterback. Or he wasn't getting any blocking, et cetera, et cetera.
Yeah,
so these things, this is so detrimental for the child because the child actually believes that he's never wrong.
Yeah.
He'll turn into Antonio Brown in no time.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
And
what's going on with him, by the way?
I have no. He got cut from the Patriots.
Really? He probably won't turn into Antonio Brown.
In terms of skill, no. But attitude, probably. Like, he feels entitled. And entitlement is huge right now. Entitlement is absolutely...
Imagine Antonio Brown had a Jerry Rice attitude.
Yeah.
He would kill it.
Well, But Jerry Rice was also a cocky motherfucker. Like, he wasn't...
He was more level-headed.
He was level-headed. But all the receivers, all superstar receivers are divas, yeah. You know?
Yeah, yeah.
Except the likes of, like, Julio Jones, Larry Fitzgerald. These guys are awesome.
Yeah.
You know, Amari Cooper.
What is it about the Patriots that has the tendency to make players shape up? I mean, it didn't work this time.
Bill Belichick, man. This guy is so... Like, his team is so disciplined.
Does he have a book?
No, he doesn't even... So he's not even part of the coaching association. So if you were to download Madden, the video game...
Yeah.
His name doesn't appear anywhere.
He doesn't want to be part of it.
No, man. He doesn't. He just wants to coach. He wants to coach and run the team. And that's what he does. He does the drafting. He coaches the team. He hires his coaches. He does everything. Okay? And again, the guy's... You know, he's married to a bombshell. Like, he's... Or it's his girlfriend or something like that. Like, he doesn't...
This guy needs to write a book.
Yeah, he doesn't really have much of a family or anything like that. He's... Like, he committed his entire life to football.
Yeah.
He's like... what's that guy from Alabama? Saban. This guy, there's a documentary about him on YouTube, and it's absolutely fascinating.
What's the name?
His last name is Saban. I forgot his
first name. And what does he do? He's a coach?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
He's a coach for Alabama. Alabama didn't lose a game for like forever.
No way.
And they won a bunch of national championships. Like, he is probably the most successful college football coach of all time.
And will he coach in the NFL?
He tried coaching the NFL, but the way he coaches, he's literally controlling every single player's life.
That doesn't work as well when you're coaching millionaires.
Yeah, it does not work that way when you're coaching millionaires, except if you're Bill Belichick. Like, when you enter the New England Patriots facility, it's a completely different vibe. Like, you're no longer doing whatever you want anymore.
Doesn't sound too much fun.
A lot of players hate it, but he just knows.
Did you see Tom Brady's
the
rings?
Six rings, yeah.
I mean, not having any of those doesn't sound like fun either.
Mm-hmm. Listen, nobody likes a kid that is a weasel. Like, nobody likes a kid that never takes the blame, you know?
Yeah.
That is just annoying.
Yeah.
And that stems from the parents. Like, it doesn't stem from the kid. The kid is not born like that. It comes from the parents.
No, he's shaped.
Yeah.
Of course.
Like, you need to put him in place, man.
So what would you do if you saw that type of behavior now? Would you have a conversation
with my kids?
With the mom? If you're coaching and you saw this again?
Well, we tried to have that conversation with her, but she wouldn't. She was very dramatic.
Like, must
she
be
was,
difficult.
Yeah, you can't have that conversation with her.
Well, at some point, you have to let the parents parent.
But then they'll pull. Yeah, but then they'll pull the single mother card, right? Well, I'm a single mother. You try to raise two kids as a single mom. And I get it. It's really hard.
Yeah.
But agreeing with every single thing your kid does and says is 100% wrong.
Mm-hmm. Oh, of course.
Like, there's nothing. it's evil.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, it's like, there's obviously a hidden agenda there.
And you know? People might not even be aware of it when they're doing it, like that.
Oh no, no, they're aware of it. Oh, they're doing it. They're aware of it, man. They have a hidden agenda. They are doing it for a reason.
I don't think that they know that they're causing harm.
Oh, I see what you're saying. Yeah.
Yeah.
I see what you're saying. Yeah.
They know they're treating them well to have their love in return, but they don't know that it's going to cause a lot of damage down
Intentions
the road.
Intentions are good. Rule number 12.
Numero 12.
Yeah.
So, maybe Rami.
I like how. What?
No. Go ahead. Give me
your.
I was
just going to say, I like how he starts the chapter because it's very offsetting. Like, it's random.
Yeah, yeah.
The title is Pet a Cat When You Encounter One on the Street, but he starts off by talking about his dog and then starts talking about an experiment on why it's important to include other people from other groups.
Yeah.
So I thought that was really interesting. Mm-hmm. So he talks about his dog first, just not to upset dog lovers, And then he jumps back into why it's important to petting a cat at the end. I thought that was really smart.
That's a bit of a funny, fluffy rule, but the point gets across. And
oh, I think the message here is to... what did I say before we started recording?
We're all going to die.
Well, no, but that's exactly like...
sky is falling.
Well, anyways, I don't know where to start because there's so much information on this last one too, but... Let's talk maybe about his daughter first.
That's well, so sad. Yeah, his daughter Michaela does have rheumatoid
arthritis.
Yeah. Juvenile arthritis, and
I think it's more common than we think. It's just people grow out of it when they hit puberty.
Yeah,
and she never did.
I don't know that many people that have arthritis. You told me about somebody else this morning. I didn't know. Mm-hmm. Maybe people just don't talk about it.
Maybe. Maybe a lot of people are just not diagnosed and then they grow out of it.
Yeah, they have joints that hurt. Mm-hmm. So the biggest takeaway I got from this chapter is a little line he put here at the beginning of the chapter. Life is suffering, but beautiful moments do exist. Mm-hmm. And that's what he's trying to get at when he says, pet a cat when you encounter one on the street.
Yeah.
There's a beautiful little paragraph here at the end. And maybe when you are going for a walk and your head is spinning, a cat will show up. And if you pay attention to it, then you will get a reminder for just 15 seconds that the wonder of being might make up for the ineradicable suffering that accompanies it.
Yeah.
So yeah, as human beings, we do focus on the problems. We do focus on what the danger is because mm-hmm. that's what allows us to, you know, yeah. move on in this life. But beautiful things do exist. Mm-hmm. And sometimes you need to stop and smell the roses or stop and pet a cat in the street when you see one.
Mm-hmm. Right?
That's my biggest takeaway from this chapter.
Yeah.
For the record, I would never stop and pet a cat
because it's dirty.
Well, no, it's just I tried doing that one time in my life and she almost scratched the crap out of me.
Oh yeah,
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 cats,
yeah.
Cats are dangerous.
Wild cats, yeah, they're not fully domesticated.
Mm-hmm. I guess we're like we're not omnipotent, obviously. Like we're gonna get hurt. Yeah. Our feelings are gonna be broken, but if there's no rainy days, then mm-hmm. you will never feel the sunshine, you know.
I love that.
Like it's you need to, I feel like you really need to feel pain. And you know, if I go to the gym and I don't feel pain the next morning,
I
feel like I didn't do a workout.
Yeah,
true. You know? But you can take supplements to help with the pain.
Yeah.
So it's relative. So, but even when you play football, it's almost like you feel better
mm-hmm.
when you have a bloody... when you have a bloody scab on your
stone cold.
Yeah, like a you know, like it's nice. And if you're playing with pain and you're having a great game, it's nice. It feels good, man.
Yeah,
like it feels like an accomplishment.
When I was playing football, that was one of the weirdest things. Was that getting hit, like not getting fucking destroyed there, but getting hit actually felt good.
Yeah,
you know, because you're like doing something.
It's a wake up call.
And you're like, you're doing something productive.
Yeah,
mm-hmm. you know.
Exactly.
If you're getting hit and it hurts, it's because you've put up a good resistance.
Yeah.
If you're just a soft you know, bag of bones and you'll fly and that's it.
It makes things interesting or even worth doing when there's limitations is what he says as well, right?
Yeah.
He's talking about Superman in there and how the writers, Superman, they would just make him stronger and stronger and different powers every issue. And people stopped caring and stopped reading because it's like, well, this guy's like indestructible, so it's not fun to read anymore. So because being comes with limitations is what makes life interesting.
It's, yeah.
They introduced kryptonite.
Yeah.
So introduce a bit of kryptonite into your life.
People started reading it again. Yeah.
Humility is your kryptonite, or maybe it's not it. Maybe it's, I don't know, something else.
Yeah.
Physical pain. Going to the gym.
Like personally, my job gives me a lot of anxiety.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah,
it
yeah.
It does. It gives a lot of anxiety. Our industry, there's a lot of anxiety and we end up staying later than we want to stay up.
Financing.
Yeah. We end up working later. We end up going out more. We end up wanting to drink more, you know? Just to, not to forget, but to almost...
ease the pain.
I guess, like to sort of ease the, take off the edge.
Yeah.
You know? But like that's what makes it cool. Like you're gonna look back at this 15, 20 years from now, and you're gonna say, man, like I worked my ass off. You know?
Oh, some of the most stressful deals are some of the most rewarding in my memory.
Yeah.
I might not have felt like it at the time, but you know, the ones that, you know, I really had to struggle to get through, and you know, there was a bit of uncertainty in there.
You have to do more legwork, and you know, uncertainty, that's the biggest, man, that's the biggest motivator.
When I feel like I'm at a standstill and nothing's, like, I just shake the cards. I just try to change something, and then, okay, the playing field has changed. There's an opening here. Let's, you know, let's take advantage of it.
Uncertainty. He talks about that very little, but uncertainty is like a surprise. You know, when you're about to get surprised, I hate surprises. But when you're about to get a surprise, you're so excited. Mm-hmm. I feel like uncertainty gives you that adrenaline rush, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah, for sure. Keeps you on your toes.
Did you know if your kids were going to be boys or girls?
Yeah.
You wanted to know?
I didn't.
You didn't?
No, but we found out. Yeah.
Okay.
I didn't want to know. I wanted it to be a surprise.
Yeah.
But, yeah.
And you?
I feel like I want to know.
You want to know?
I want to prepare. Yeah.
It's everybody enough, wants to prepare.
It's hard enough finding a name.
But let me tell you something.
For the kid.
It's the biggest surprise of your life.
Yeah, either way. Whether you know if it's a girl or not.
When it comes out, it's the biggest surprise of your life. I don't know. That's what somebody told me, at least. But I never experienced it. I wish I could.
Man. It's like telling me, hey, you're going to get $1 million at the end of the month. You got to wait. I don't know if that's a good analogy, but I don't think I can.
Yeah. Our buddy Phil just had a kid a year and a half ago.
Juche?
2 years ago.
Juche?
Yeah.
Yeah, something like that, yeah.
A little over 2 years ago. Yeah. And I said, are you going to find out the sex? He says, no, man. In this calculated life, we have so very few surprises.
That's how he said it, but I remember him saying something like that.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, the guy's the pilot. He's got everything calculated. He's, you know, everything certain. Well, not everything, but he says we have so very few surprises. Listen,
at the end of the day, it won't be my decision. Renee can say
she can call it. She can call it the way she is.
It's gonna be her call, and she deserves to have control over that. I find.
Of course.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Either way.
And there was another thing from this chapter that I found interesting is that Jordan said that if his son was born perfect, he would not love him as much.
Yeah, nobody loves a perfect child.
Yeah. So I found that interesting, and it makes total sense to me. You know, you don't love people for their, you know, indestructibility.
No.
You love them for their ability to learn.
Vulnerability. And,
you know, to get better.
If you were to meet a guy that's just absolutely perfect, you know, tall, brown eyes, blue eyes, brown hair, super successful, fitted suits.
Yeah.
And he doesn't act like a douchebag, but he's super confident. Like, you're never going to compete with this guy. He's just an absolute superstar. Yeah. How much are you going to like him?
Maybe
you're
going
to find ways to dislike him.
Yeah.
Maybe I would not dislike him, but I would not be attracted. You know, I would not be like, I want to be this guy's friend. You know.
Maybe that's why Tom Brady is hated so much.
Exactly. Know? Tom Brady. But you have to respect the guy. For sure. So you sort of respect him, but you're not going to relate to him very much.
Why is he hated so much?
Because he's perfect, man.
But then you look at Michael Jordan, and he was loved by all.
I'll tell you why. There's nothing wrong with Tom Brady. Tom Brady has a perfect diet. He's 42 years old. He has a beautiful wife, a great family. There's nothing wrong with this guy's life. He's just a freaking hard worker. From the outside, from what we see, we don't know what he's going through. I'm sure he's going through his own stuff. Right? But Michael Jordan, he was a gambler.
Yeah, okay, that's true.
Got cut from his team.
Yeah. He has a story. But Tom Brady was a fifth or sixth round pick, right?
Yeah.
But Michael Jordan was very flawed as a human because he was the cockiest guy on the basketball court. Okay?
Nobody seemed to bother anyone though. Like, look at Kobe. Kobe was a show off and people didn't like him because of that.
Yeah.
I don't know what
But the ones that did like him loved him. You know?
Oh yeah, I was always a big Kobe fan.
Yeah, but like for example, like this is why I don't like Sidney Crosby, because he's too perfect.
Yeah,
and this is why I like Ovechkin more, because he's more real. You know,
he is, yeah.
That's why I like Ovechkin more. I wish the roles were reversed because I want to like Sidney Crosby, but I can't find it in me to like the guy.
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. You know? Definitely prefer Ovechkin over Crosby, and like just the backstory, and you know,
the character, man. You like the character,
and like Conor McGregor, just his story of coming from absolutely nothing, right?
Yeah, but now he's a little too obnoxious.
He is, but for a long time, that's what gained him people's, you know, admiration.
Maybe that's his way to coast, though. Maybe that's his way to keep making money by being loud. You know, like he doesn't have to fight anymore.
Yeah,
just be this character that he's just created.
He's trying to be relevant.
Yeah, yeah. But hey,
is he gonna fight again?
I don't know. I'm not into UFC. It scares me now.
Yeah.
Did you guys see that boxer that got knocked out dead?
No.
Dead. He died.
No, it's going to happen. You're getting punched in the freaking face.
Man, they should get rid of that sport.
The UFC?
No, the boxing.
Oh, boxing? Really?
Yeah, man. It was boxing.
I didn't see that.
I saw it. Yeah.
That's wild.
That happened not too long ago.
Mm-hmm.
He died today.
He died today?
Was it yesterday or today? Yeah, something like that.
He got hit yesterday, died today? And he died today.
Yeah, you watch that video and you basically somebody die right in front of you.
But you're saying it shouldn't exist because all you're doing is pecking in the face and the head. It's more dangerous than UFC.
I think UFC is a little more, I don't know, man. Because boxing, like you're going for the head the whole time.
Yeah.
Right? And UFC, you're almost... Yeah, that's who. What's his name, Rael?
Patrick Day. He's only 27.
Man, that's wild.
Yeah, yesterday passed.
Fuck.
Oh. You think the other guy's gonna keep fighting now?
Oh, man.
Okay, yeah, I saw that on Facebook.
Jesus.
That's it?
No.
Oh.
So it wasn't anything crazy.
Look at that guy still cheering. He doesn't know what's going on.
So did he get up after?
That's sad.
Is that the hit, Chris?
That's the video I saw.
Man, that's rough.
R.I.P.
That's rough.
So, can I start by giving my...
Yes, I'm going to add a timestamp. Go in 10 seconds.
What are we calling this? Our bacon review?
How many bacons, man?
You still have your bookmark?
I do. Yeah, it's in my car, though. I dropped it.
Okay.
The bacon review.
So, can I start?
Yeah.
I really enjoyed this book. Hmm. If there's one thing that I did not enjoy about it is every time he talked about like the Bible and stuff like that, I was completely lost because I know nothing about the Bible.
Mm.
And I just lost interest when he started talking about that. Mm. But that being said, I really like this book. And what I liked the most about it is the emotion you can feel when you're reading it and hear when you're listening to it. The guy cries when he's reading his book.
Yeah.
A few times. His voice changes and for like minutes long. And it really gets you when he talks about, what was it? Was it about his friend when he, where he's from there?
Chris?
Forget the part exactly where it was, but you can feel him start crying about when he's reading the book. So it felt very real. It's not my favorite book ever. It's a very good book, but I'm going to give it a 4.5.
Okay.
4.5 bacon for Chris.
Four and a half bacons, eh?
Yeah.
Mm.
Too much Bible stories in there for me, for my liking.
Yeah. You would get them if you actually read the Bible.
I have no interest in reading it, though.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
I'm giving it a 4.8.
Woo!
Yeah, I think it's a great book. It's a book that definitely resonated with me for sure. 4.8 is what I'm giving it. 4.8 on 50.
Oh shit. Sorry, Rami.
That's okay, man. Yeah, 4.8. It's honestly, I love Jordan Peterson. Huge fan of him. A huge fan of his. I think just the topics that he brings forward is so gutsy. You know, like nobody else is talking about this stuff.
It's tough, man.
Like, and you know, all the hate. He doesn't live a perfect life.
Of course not.
He doesn't. He went through his own struggles. He's still dealing with his own struggles. And that makes me...
Sorry, speaking of which, is he still in rehab? Is he out?
I guess he's still there because I haven't heard anything else from it.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
So, like, he is... Like, he almost makes you feel what he's feeling, right?
Yeah.
And there's a lot of haters, but you have to understand where he comes from, what he's talking about, and the logic behind his ideas before you jump to conclusions.
Yeah.
A lot of people, if they listen to one YouTube video that's like in this all scripts of what he said in different interviews, they can turn him, they can make him look like the devil. You know?
Like, of course. Four or five times in there, he talks about Columbine, and it's like, it's not to praise the killers at all. It's just to use that as an example.
Right.
So yeah.
Keep on reading, and then you'll understand, right?
Of course.
Yeah. But yeah. Now you're starting to make me regret my 4.5. It's a really good book. I like that.
Yeah. Oh, it's a great book.
So I'm going to put it pretty close to yours. At 4.75.
Okay.
And
just give it a 4.8, man.
No, I don't want to, I don't want to do the same. If I do different, I'll go 4.85. Okay. Just so we're different. So 4.75 for me, and I would put it right up there probably as one of the books I would recommend for self-development.
Yeah.
You know, just behind Napoleon Hill's Think and Grow Rich.
Mm.
These concepts are structured. They're very organized, and they're a great roadmap to follow towards success.
I love it. Yeah.
I think Jordan is controversial because he risks talking about very difficult subjects.
Mm-hmm.
How many times during this past 6 weeks did we get into difficult topics, you know, and we stumbled? And I can't talk for you boys, but I feel like I wasn't really expressing what I wanted to say. And
it's
if
hard.
We had a bigger audience, I probably would not have ventured even that far.
Right.
So I'm thankful that, you know, we're starting with this book while we still have a small audience, because we can go there and not be afraid of the huge backlash. But my hat's off to him, because I think that he's tackling very, very popular subjects with an unpopular opinion.
He's one of the greatest thinkers of our time, I think.
I believe so.
Yeah.
I believe so.
Well, cheers to Jordan Peterson.
Salut, mon ami. Hope things go better for you in the rehab. I'm sure they will. So, that's it. Highly recommend this book. Hope you guys enjoyed this series. We have 6 episodes, 2 chapters per episode.
Next book?
Next booked. So there was a few recommendations. One of them is called EQ. Emotional intelligence.
That's the one you want. Let's just go with that.
Let's take a look at it. Let's take 1 minute.
EQ Holmes.
Is that 2.0?
Oh God.
Which one are we doing?
Are we gonna have somebody joining us?
Yeah, Cedric will.
I like guests. They make me happy.
So, this seems to be...
Interesting music you got in the background there.
Yeah. Feel like doing pottery.
The song from Ghost.
Yeah.
Rahel, did you look up books on EQ? So, we're most likely going to... have a book on EQ. Oh, what's the one there in the middle with the rainbow? That's the one that Cedric.
EQ Applied.
EQ Applied?
Yeah.
Okay. Anyways, you guys okay if we don't mention the name right now? We'll make a selection, and then next week we'll get started.
All right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Are we looking for a book on emotional intelligence, or do we already have a book? Like
Cedric had one.
Okay.
But we don't have to do that one.
Okay.
Let's just research it a bit. You know,
well, if we're going to have a guest, why not let him pick?
We'll choose the book.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. But that's the subject for next book.
All right. Sounds good.
Okay, les amis.
Thanks for watching.
We're good. Ciao, everybody.